And thank you for always being there with us and journeying with us in our quest to understand our faith as Catholics. Today we continue our discussion on the sacrament of holy matrimony, marriage. I am always yours, Reverend Father Boniface Nebo Anasija, with my brother and colleague,
Father Silvanus Ame. Welcome to the program today.
Our discussion today shall be focused on the canonical and liturgical forms of marriage. And to unpack and discuss this, or give us a better understanding of it, is a very fine gentleman and priest of the Catholic Church, who is currently the Director of Pastoral Affairs, as well as the Deputy Secretary General of the Catholic Secretariat of Nigeria. I'm talking about very Reverend Father Michael Banjo. Father, we're glad to have you.
Thank you very much, Father Boniface and Father Silvanus. Good morning, viewers.
Thank you. To begin with, it is only good and necessary that we understand from the very root what the liturgical and canonical forms of marriage are. Thank you. You may pick it up from there, Father. Thank you.
All right. Thank you very much, Father Boniface. The canonical form of marriage is that form of marriage that belongs to us as Catholics. It belongs to the Church as an independent body. Independent body compared to Nigeria, for instance, as a state. The traditional form of marriage as another juridical system. In the Church, we have our own system as an independent body. So in the civil forum, we talk about civil marriage. Traditional forum, we talk about traditional marriage. In the Church, we talk about the canonical form of marriage. So that is what belongs to us as a people called Catholics. And this form consists of the couple exchanging their consent before an officiant who is representing the Church officially, and also before two witnesses. So that is the summary of what the canonical form is. And the liturgical form will be the context, the liturgical context within which this canonical form of marriage is celebrated. Okay. So you can say that canonical form of marriage, a couple exchanging their consent before the priest and two witnesses, being celebrated within liturgy of the Eucharist, for instance. So that's what we mean by the liturgical form.
Okay, thank you very much, Father.
So you have explained that the canonical form basically revolves around the couple exchanging vows, mm-hmm. which is what makes marriage.
Yes.
In the presence of a representative of the Church mm-hmm. and two witnesses.
Witnesses, yes. Okay.
Yeah. Yeah. Besides these, is there any other, or are there any other elements that must be present for a marriage to have canonical form?
Oh, yes, yes, yes. Very well. Like I said, that's just the summary. Mm-hmm. There are other very important elements, very, very important. Number one is that the officiant must have faculty. So it's not just enough for a priest to be present. You must have faculty. And this faculty can belong to you by law, by virtue of your office. Okay. So if a parish priest, in the case of a parish priest, it belongs to him by law. The law attributes to him the faculty to celebrate marriage. So as long as he has been appointed to a parish, he has the faculty.
Sorry, for the sake of our viewers, by faculty, what exactly do you mean?
Yeah, faculty means the right to be able to celebrate, to be able to officiate at marriages.
Okay.
Yes.
Okay.
So if
the faculty, the authority.
The authority, exactly. To act in this particular capacity, yes. Okay. The local ordinary, has the faculty by virtue of his office. The law gives it to him. So it's either by law or by delegation.
Okay.
So you are not a parish priest, you are an assistant parish priest, you have it by delegation. And a priest could come to, who is not a parish priest, could come to a parish to be the officiant at a marriage in that other parish. And he celebrates, he officiates at that marriage. by virtue of the delegation he has received.
Okay.
Yes, so that could be general delegation or special delegation.
Okay.
You know, so summarily, so that's one of the elements that must be there. There must be faculty. The officiant must have the use of reason at the time of the celebration. So if he's intoxicated, for instance,
okay,
then the form is deficient.
Okay.
Yes, not absent.
Okay.
There is a difference between absence of form and deficiency of form.
Okay.
So, yes, we'll clarify that.
Okay.
The officiant must ask for and receive the consent of the parties. So before the parties exchange consent, you know that thing we say, since you have decided to celebrate, come enter into the sacrament of holy matrimony, join your right hand
and declare
consent. Yes, so you must, the officiant must.
So the declaration is very key.
Yes, it's very, very key.
Okay.
So that is asking for the declaration, and then you receive the consent. At the end of the day, at the end of the exchange of consent, the officiant also says some words which concludes, "What God has joined together, let no man put asunder." That's the reception.
The reception. Okay.
Yes.
Okay. Thank you very much, Father. You know, while you were just talking, I noted something about this declaration of consent by the parties involved in the sacrament of matrimony and the reception of this consent by the priest who officiates.
Yes.
Now, to give it a better understanding, what are the implications of these two acts to the canonical form?
Yeah, when those acts are absent, then the canonical form is deficient. Formally, with when the canonical form was introduced by the Council of Trent in 1563, it just required the priest to be present. But later on, 1908 thereabout, by the decree non temere, the presence of the priest was modified, that it has to be an active presence. So the priest has to be present actively, not just passively.
Okay.
So it means, and they said, that active presence means that you ask for the consent of the parties and then you receive it at the end of it. So when it is not there, the canonical form is deficient. So you talk about defective form of marriage.
Okay, in your responses, it is clear to us what exactly the couple are doing at the celebration of marriage.
Yeah.
Basically, they exchange consent to make the marriage.
Yes.
You have also made clear what exactly the priest is doing, which you just said now is an active
participation.
An active role to ask for and to receive the consent.
Yes.
In your opening response, you also talked about witnesses.
Yes.
You said two witnesses.
Yes.
What is or what are the specific role or roles of the witnesses in the sacrament of marriage? What exactly is expected of them? What do they do? Why are they there?
Well, the substantial role of the witnesses is to say, "I was there. I witnessed," just like the word suggests. Yes, I witnessed this act of exchange of consent, which means they have to be physically there and morally there.
Okay.
Physical presence means that I am there physically. Moral presence means I'm actively present. You know, I have my use of reason, because you can be present, but your mind is far away or you have no use of reason. So it's not enough for you just to be there like a log of wood is present.
Yeah.
Your mind is there, you can see what is going on, you can hear the words, you can understand the words either directly or through an interpreter. So, but your basic function as a witness is to be able to say, "I was there, I saw what happened, there was real exchange of consent."
Okay. Yes. So what qualifies one to perform this function or this role of witnessing?
Who qualifies to be a witness?
Yes.
What are the qualifications required of somebody to be a witness?
Yes, the qualification required, most importantly, is that you have the use of reason.
Okay.
That, and canon law presumes that you have that use of reason at age 7.
Okay.
So you have the use of reason habitually, but also actually. That means at the moment of that celebration, you have the use of reason. So those are the main qualifications required to be a witness.
So you mentioned age 7.
Yes.
As the age for use of reason.
Yes.
Does it mean, therefore, that somebody who is 10, for example, can be a witness at
marriage?
A marriage?
Yeah, it sounds funny, but according to universal law, it means the person can, you know.
The particular laws can modify that.
Well, I haven't seen any particular law anywhere, you know, changing the age, you know, but universal law kind of makes it possible for somebody who is 10 years to be a witness at marriages, because the use of reason is presumed at the age of 7.
Okay, so you're still on this witness.
Yes, yes.
From what you've just described, it appears as though the function or the role of the witness is more of a legal function than a pastoral one. Legal in the sense that I can bear testimony that this happened.
Yes.
But I'm wondering, is there also a pastoral angle to the role of witnesses?
Yes. Now, in order for us to understand the role of witnesses, we need to go to the history of the canonical form. The canonical form of marriage was not always there.
Yes,
like I said, it came into being in 1563, you know, with the Tamatic decree of the Council of Trent.
Mm-hmm.
Why did it come into being? Because before then, just like the marriage at Cana, couples would celebrate within their homes. The presence of the priest or the official witness of the church was not required for the marriage to be valid.
Okay.
Because of what you said, consent makes marriage. That has always been, you know, the teaching of the church. You know, but the problem was some had clandestine marriages. They could just be in their room, they exchange consent, and they say, we are married. So how do you prove that in the external forum?
Yes.
The problem of inheritance from children of such marriages became problematic also. How do you prove to me that you were married in the first place, let alone that the children are legitimate and have rights to inheritance? You know, so there were such problems and all that problems. That's just one of the many problems. So you needed the canonical form to say you have to exchange your consent publicly. Publicly meant before an officiant representing the church and before witnesses. So the role of the witnesses, coming back to your question, is that, yes, this marriage took place. The ratio legis, that is the motivation for the law, you know, is primarily that of to witness, not a pastoral. Of course, canon law, as they say, everything is ordered to the pastoral good, you know, the salvation of souls. So canon law itself is pastoral, because when you celebrate it within the canonical form, you are also pastorally caring for that marriage, because you guard the commitment. It is known. So something that is known is difficult for you to break away, compared to two persons just exchanging consent in a bedroom. It is easy for them to just go their separate ways. Nobody knows that they are married.
You know. So we're going to hang it on the
Everything Catholic, a program that discusses anything and everything about the Catholic Church, faith, doctrines, morals, canon law, church governance, papal documents, you name it. As long as it is Catholic, it shall be discussed. Join Father Ames Ivanus and Father Nebo Boniface, two priests passionate about teaching the true faith of the Catholic Church, as their hosts, bishops, priests, religious, and distinguished laymen and women, to discuss and simplify the wealth of the Church's teachings. Everything Catholic, showing on Catholic television, CTV. Everything Catholic, teaching the faith.
Welcome back, dear viewers. It is still Everything Catholic with Reverend Father Silvano Sanme and my very self, Father Boniface Nebo. We still have with us discussing the canonical and liturgical forms of marriage. The Director of Pastoral Affairs and Deputy Secretary General, Catholic Secretariat of Nigeria,
Father Michael Banjo.
So we'll continue our discussion. And Father, under a situation of mixed marriage, which could be between a baptized Catholic and maybe a separated brethren,
like a Protestant, what are the implications or the demands of, if there are any, the canonical forms of marriage in this situation? How does it apply?
Okay, in a situation of mixed marriage,
yes.
Mixed marriage is understood as union between a Catholic and a baptized non-Catholic.
Exactly.
Yes. Before I go on, it is important to, because we sometimes make that mix up. When we talk about baptized non-Catholic, it doesn't mean everybody who says, I am baptized. We are talking about baptized non-Catholics whose baptism are recognized by the church. So there are some churches whose baptism we do not recognize. So they wouldn't come strictly under mixed marriage.
Okay.
Rather, they will come under disparity of calls. You understand? So that means in relation to the canonical form, we have to treat the two separately.
Separately, yes. I was actually going to come there.
Okay, very good. So in the area of mixed marriages, what you need is the permission of the bishop to go ahead.
Okay.
You need the permission of the bishop to go ahead. But if the mixed marriage will take place in the church of the non-Catholic party, in the Anglican church, for instance, you will then require dispensation from the canonical form of marriage. You know, because the priest is not going to be there.
Yes.
You know, the officiants of the church.
Mm-hmm.
Now, if it is the other one, disparity of calls, what you would need is not permission of the local ordinary, but dispensation from the impediment of disparity of court.
Okay.
And again, if the marriage is going to take place in the religious house of the other party, be it Muslim or Christian, whose baptism we do not recognize, then they also need dispensation from the canonical form of marriage. But there is also a third aspect which is possible. If the priest is going to be present in that church as the officiant, then first of all, the priest will need the permission of the bishop to go.
Mm-hmm.
But then we are not talking about dispensation from the canonical form of marriage. Because even though it is not taking place in the Catholic Church, the priest, the officiant is there, the couple is there,
the witnesses
are there. So it is the canonical form of marriage.
Okay. Father, you mentioned something about dispensation from impediments. So what are the impediments in this context, talking about the canonical form of marriage in relation to mixed marriage?
Well, you know, there are three categories.
Okay.
Of three categories of elements that can nullify a marriage. We talk about impediments.
Okay, fine, yes.
On their own.
Separately,
yes. So disparity of court is an impediment.
Okay.
Then we talk about the juridical, the exchange of consent that is juridically efficient.
Okay.
You know, so that means when there is a defective exchange of consent, the marriage is null. Then the third category is the one we're talking about, the form of marriage. So I just brought it in
because
you need to treat it formally.
Exactly. So that clarification was
yes.
quite necessary.
Yes, yes.
Better
thank
understand
you.
It.
Yes,
okay.
Thank you.
So
thank you very
much. We've talked largely on the canonical forms of marriage. On the liturgical form
yes.
of marriage, okay. What specific rites must be conformed to, must be observed in order to meet the liturgical form of marriage? I think that of the canonical form is quite clear now.
Okay, very good. The liturgical form consists mainly of four elements.
Okay.
The introductory rites, the liturgy of the word, the celebration of the marriage itself,
okay.
and then the liturgy of the Eucharist. Now, the liturgy of the for the celebration of marriage could be with Mass, without Mass, before a layperson, and it could be an order of celebrating marriage between two catechumens who are not yet baptized, they are on the way, but they are not, so you have a special rite
for them.
In that rite, there is no liturgy of the Eucharist.
Yes.
You know, so these are, so that means you have three of the four various elements in the liturgy in that situation between two catechumens, but basically there are four of them that I just mentioned.
Okay.
And all must be there to have the proper liturgical form for the marriage.
That's right.
Or at least three.
Yes, at least three, yes. Yes. The introductory, the...
About the place where marriage takes place.
Yes.
Excuse me, please. You mentioned a situation of a marriage taking place in the church of a baptized non-Catholic.
Yes.
Now, I recall a canon law lecturer in one seminary once said that when proper permission is sought and given, a priest, for instance, can go to the home of a baptized or baptized couple during their traditional marriage and receive their consent in the presence of witnesses.
Yes.
And this does not affect in any way the form of marriage.
Yes.
So now about the place where the marriage takes place,
mm-hmm.
what further implications are there, or what implications are there, if any, on the canonical form of marriage?
First of all, it is important to know that whenever a law is going to be invalidated, the law must state so expressly.
Okay.
So if a law has not said, if you celebrate it in this place, it will invalidate, then if I celebrate it in that place, it will not invalidate.
Mm.
You know, you will see the canonical form of marriage, Canon 1108, I read, it says only those marriages are valid which are contracted before the local ordinary pastor or a priest or deacon delegated by either of them who assists, and before two witnesses. It says only those marriages are valid. It must say so. Canon 1118 regulates what you're talking about. You will see nothing about valid comes up. It says the form established above, that is the canonical form, must be observed if at least one of the parties, a marriage between Catholics or between a Catholic party and non-Catholic baptized party is to be celebrated in a parish church. It can be celebrated in another church or oratory with the permission of the local ordinary or pastor. You can say nothing about validity.
Yes.
Second paragraph, the local ordinary can permit a marriage to be celebrated in another suitable place. And that answers your question.
Okay.
That they are having their traditional rites, and the local ordinary, using his discretion, says this is a suitable place, grants the permission.
Okay.
Practical example, Bishop Fagun of Ekiti Diocese used to do that. He used to give the permission, you know, for his priest to go to the homes of the people, the couple, while they were having the traditional marriage, and that helped the families to save costs.
Yes.
So they had two forms of marriage
in one
celebration. Yeah. So that's very well, very possible.
Thank you very much, Father. Now, talking about the possibility of the lack of canonical form in any manner, does it sufficiently suffice for a petition or call for declaration of nullity of marriage?
Okay.
Or no?
Yes. You know, at the beginning, I mentioned distinction between lack of form and defect of form.
Okay.
They are two different things.
Okay.
Let me just quickly explain. Lack of form means that you have not done any marriage, you have not celebrated your marriage in the church. So somebody has done civil marriage, you have done traditional marriage, that marriage lacks canonical form altogether.
Entirely. Okay.
Defect of form means that you have done, you have come to the church. But earlier on I was talking about faculty.
Exactly.
The priest lacks the faculty to celebrate that marriage. So there was canonical form, but it was defective. So this one, there was nothing at all. The first one, lack of form. This one, it was defective.
Or a deficiency on the part of the witnesses too can lead to defect.
Exactly, yes. If you have,
form.
Yes. If you have two witnesses were present, but one was drunk.
Yes.
Okay.
Is deficient.
How about the ministers themselves? Maybe in the case of a simulated consent.
Well, that will now come under defective consent. You know, I was talking about three categories.
Okay,
yes, that will now come under defective consent.
Okay.
You know, so in a situation where you have defect of form, then you submit a petition when you want to go your separate way, because you are already living together as married couple in the church. But it was now discovered that there was a defective form, as in, for one reason or the other. You submit your petition to the tribunal, and it would be a ground of nullity if it is proven.
Okay, all right.
So if there's a deficiency in form, is there a possibility of rectifying it?
Oh yes. It can be rectified.
So what happens to?
It's either you exchange anew,
okay,
or if that is difficult, you could you heal it from the roots. You know, you heal through administrative processes. Yes, you just heal the problem.
Okay.
You know, the sickness from the roots.
On witnesses, you know, several times discussions come up on issues like this.
Yes.
And from what we've talked about here, which I asked earlier, it appears as though the role of the witnesses is more legal than pastoral.
Exactly.
In that case, is it possible that a non-Catholic mm-hmm. can play the role of witnesses at a marriage of Catholics?
Yeah, this is an interesting question that has always come up.
Yeah.
If we look at the requirements of the law, it says use of reason, let them be present. This is universal law.
Yeah.
And we have talked about the history of the law, the purpose. It means that obviously they can. They are not, we are not talking about godparents for baptism.
Yes, yes.
Who have a necessary role of ensuring they live the faith. So they themselves need to know the faith. So in marriage, it is not about teaching them marriage. It is about, I was there. This union took place.
So it happened.
Yes, yes. But what you have is a situation where in many places, there have been people bringing in other requirements. You must be a Catholic. But I always ask, what if the couple insists that these are the two witnesses I want to be there, and the two witnesses are not Catholics? What happens? You will therefore say they cannot go ahead. That means you have introduced another impediment to marriage, and only the Roman pontiff has the authority to introduce impediments.
You see, this is the reason why I actually brought this question up, because in a lot of parishes, not only is there an insistence that the witnesses must be Catholics, but that they must themselves be a couple.
Exactly.
Yeah.
They must themselves be a couple,
yeah, married,
who are wedded in the church and are practicing.
Yeah.
Marriage.
Yeah. So I feel it is important to make clarification on mm-hmm. this point for
yeah.
the sake of all those who, one way or the other, may have gotten it wrong.
Yes. Now, it is important to note that, yes, this practice of the witnesses being Catholics, they are couples, but now we call them sponsors. The law calls them witnesses. I will not call them so. I will not, because I'm a canonist, I will use what the legislator has used, witness. That's the technical. It is a good thing, as long as they are fulfilling what the legislator has, you know, has in mind, the mens legislatoris, that is, to witness the marriage. So whoever they are, so if they are married, they are practicing Catholics, they are in good standing, very good. Those qualities do not negate. But the question I asked earlier is, what if the parties, what if the parties insist that these are the witnesses I want to use? So you are going to say they cannot go ahead because they must be, but the universal legislator says they can be persons who are not Catholics, because what is required is that they have the use of reason. And that means it's going to be a violation of Canon 1058, the jus connubi, that everybody who has not been prohibited from marrying has the right to marry. So you are going to deny people a fundamental right, a natural right, a divine right, you know. So we need to know where to, that this practice is very good, but where you see a couple who is insistent that these are the people I want to use as my witnesses, I don't think you can, yes.
Okay,
I don't think
thank you very much, Father. Just for the last time, before we wrap up this discussion today, now, for all of us, both as ministers and as priests, witnesses and the young people out there seeking to be married, and even those who are married.
Yeah.
What will be your last words to all of us with respect to teaching the faith and having a good understanding of the canonical form and liturgical form of marriage and the implications for marriages.
I would say that all of us need to study more and more what the church has in mind. You know, the mind of the church, because we as ministers, that is what we represent. We are there to, not to do our own will, but to do the will of the church. And the church, in her wisdom, has brought out guidelines that have evolved over the years, centuries, you know, of wisdom is what we have in the code of canon law. So it would be good for us to really understand the mind of the church. For priests, for couples, that's the importance of pre-marriage course.
Exactly.
For the witnesses themselves, yeah. You need to ask questions. What are my roles? What are my roles? So that you can, all of us can effectively play our roles.
Beautiful. Thank you for always being there. Dear viewers, it's been Everything Catholic. And today, we have with us, and he has been discussing the canonical and liturgical forms of marriage. This is saying a very big thank you to Very Reverend Father Michael Banjo, and indeed, help us to keep this program going on. Your suggestions, recommendations, and over and above all, your supports are very, very important. Send in your adverts as well as sponsorship. Follow us on all our social media platforms at Everything Catholic. It is me signing out, Reverend Father Boniface Debo. See you next week. God bless you.